Well, I'm not a lawyer, so that how did we get into this issue of gene patents? Well, Cancer Council Australia became involved when, as you've heard, Genetic Technologies in Australia, who'd licensed the testing of the BRCA1 and 2 from Myriad, threatened to enforce the monopoly over the test. And this potentially could have reduced the availability of the test and increased the cost, as had happened in Canada. And so the women and men who have been referred for this testing because perhaps a relative of theirs had breast cancer may not have been able to access the test. The other thing is that there had been at that time unusually government-funded laboratories set up in each of the states. And if you project this further, you might say that if only one laboratory can do a test, you may then have downskilling of the people in other laboratories if you look at it more globally. Eventually, with public pressure and other things, Genetic Technologies withdrew this chance to have a monopoly over this test, but it wasn't the law that allowed that to happen. The law had been interpreted that gave them the monopoly, and so we couldn't turn to the law, and it was perhaps just fortuitous that this occurred. And I just reflect on the question that was asked by Graham about whether if you have publicly funded research, you can commercialise it. My answer to that would be you can commercialise it, but not if it's going to be against the public good. That would seem to be unreasonable to me, but then I'm not a lawyer. Yesterday's news, I'm sorry to give you yesterday's news, but yesterday in the paper we had this story that Aussies cracked the pancreatic genetic mystery, and in fact the paper from some of the work being done now in sequencing cancers, the Human Genome Project's been done, and now there's a whole lot of projects around the world. Collaborative projects, the information from those projects is widely available to everyone, of sequencing cancers. And the beauty of sequencing cancers is that we'll find out genetic alterations are driving those cancers. We'll be able to diagnose cancers more easily, and we'll be able to target treatments, if we have developed them, at the particular genetic changes in the products of those genes. So in this study, they were actually looking at pancreatic cancer, which has been incredibly difficult to treat. And to a certain extent, some of the reason it's been difficult to treat is tied up here. The study identified more than 2,000 genetic mutations. One was found in 90% of the samples, while thousands of others were present in only 1 or 2% of tumours. So that means if you did have a targeted therapy, or what is more likely to be several targeted therapies, because you're unlikely to knock out this solid tumour, there's not unlikely to be just one driving mutation. If you had several targeted therapies, they may only work in 2 or 3% of the pancreatic cancer. So we now not only have pancreatic cancer, we have hundreds of different types potentially of pancreatic cancer. And this is what personalised medicine is all about. So when I talk about having to get the business of patenting genes correct at this stage, it's because the floodgates are opening, and this tells us why the floodgates are opening. So to see genetic changes, Andrew Bianchini was one of the authors, to see genetic changes in one of the pathways they found, which was opens the door for potential new therapies. It is a new marker of pancreatic cancer that can be used to detect prognoses and treatment. And this was an axon guidance pathway that they found that they hadn't detected. So this is why we need to focus on this issue now, because the whole future of cancer diagnosis and treatment is going to be a part of this. I want to go back, because history is really quite interesting, and just look at the Herceptin story, or trastuzumab. This is the targeted therapy that really made quite a difference in breast cancer. And I got this particular version of the story from Dr. Mukherjee's book, The Emperor of All Maladies, which is a sort of a history of cancer in the United States, well, around the world, but he's from the United States. In the early 80s, in Weinberg's lab, one of his researchers isolated the new oncogene from a rat neuroblastoma. And the new oncogene was quite remarkable because instead of being internalized, it had a bit sticking out that you could get to, which was great. And what he managed to do was he managed to produce an antibody against this cancer-causing gene. However, because that was his job, he didn't do the next thing you could do. He didn't take the antibody and put it in a rat with neuroblastoma and see if his antibody actually shrunk the tumour. I mean, it might seem obvious, but he was sort of focused on his bit of what to do with these genes, and he didn't do it. Now, the problem of limiting by a patent researcher in, and only allowing one group of researchers is that's the sort of thing that can happen. I mean, these people now kick themselves because a few years later, the story, they could have been the first to describe an antibody against an oncogene actually doing something. They didn't think of it and they didn't do it. It took until 1984 where the human equivalent, the HER2, was discovered, but a clinician who was involved at the time actually got the probe from Genentech, who discovered it. He'd had a panel of cancers that he could test for overproduction of the HER2 gene, and subsequently he tested it on breast cancer and found that very aggressive cancers were shrinking in a way they never had before. And then he eventually put it in women. This was the Brad Peel, one of the first women to ever have Herceptin, who is still alive today. So she was a remarkable example of that working. And when it was subsequently used, it had a dramatic effect on survival when it was added to conventional chemotherapy in patients with breast cancer. And so what we found with Herceptin, a targeted therapy, was that when the appropriate experiments were done, we developed a whole new treatment that has been incredibly useful. So that was one of the first of them. And another one that was very early in the piece was a drug known as Gleevec or imatinib that worked in chronic myeloid leukemia and a very rare type of tumour called a GIST tumour. And we were actually quite lucky in this one because the product of the genes that the small molecule antagonised was actually the thing that was driving the gene along, driving the cancer along. So that when we blocked it, the cancer actually started to shrink. And these cancers were pretty much resistant to anything else. So we had those first two. But we're really at the threshold of this sort of thing, these sort of treatments being used for all types of cancers. And the thing was that we were seeing very dramatic changes. The difference in these two is 6 or 7 weeks, and we were seeing shrinkage of tumours. Here's a big tumour there on a PET scan. It's disappeared. In fact, it hadn't anatomically, but its activity had disappeared. So we were seeing this was proof of principle that this type of therapy was going to be quite different from the conventional drugs we had up until that time. The reason I make that comment is that I just want to underline the importance of getting it right now because the floodgates are about to open. And the next 3 or 4 slides are just my shock and awe slides about the number of targeted therapies that are already being developed and the number of cancers in which they're being developed. So here's a number of small molecules with their NIBs and or antibodies with the MAB for breast cancer, for chronic myeloid leukemia, non-small cell lung cancer, colorectal cancer, kidney cancer, melanoma, thyroid cancer, and so it goes on into the lymphomas and myelomas. There's some of these targeted therapies that don't target the tumour, they target the blood vessels that mean that the tumour can spread. Or in fact, you can not only target it with the targeted therapy, you can add a toxin to the targeted therapy and have a double go at the tumour. It gets in to the thing that's driving the tumour along, but it also delivers a poison and a second go. So we really are on the threshold. This is not just being speculative. And what's more, the cost of the tests are coming down. If you want to sequence the genome, you have to be very wealthy. Now you've probably got closer to needing $1,000. So in mass, it is feasible that we can test people and look at their therapies. So there's no doubt in my mind that targeted therapies for cancer-specific mutation offers the hope of personalised medicine. The big problem, however, is that it was just fortunate that the first tumours that responded, we actually managed to find something that targeted the driving mutation. In most other tumours, we might need 6 or 7 or 8 different drugs targeting different bits of what makes them grow in order to kill them. And so the point of that is that if someone owned the patent over 6 or 7 or 8 genes and we have to pay money, we wouldn't just be paying to get one, we'd have to pay for 8 to cover the spectrum of genes that you need. And so I think that makes the practical problem far more complex. Well, what was the problem in the BRCA 1 and 2 study in terms of my interpretation of what I've been told about the law? Well, granting patents required that the subject be patentable, and so the question is a gene patentable? It had to be novel, there had to be an inventive step, and it had to have practical use. The problem was that if any one of multiple claims met the criteria, these patents were broadly granted, and so you actually got the patent over the gene if you managed to meet any of these, and this is what's happened over the last 30 years. So what is the remedy for this? Well, you can change the law so that gene is simply not patentable material because it's been discovered and there's no inventive step. And there are a lot of arguments that go around the matter of, is an isolated gene, is there anything inventive? Well, there might be something inventive the first time you isolate it, but once every PhD student can do it, you can no longer claim that. I'm not denigrating PhD students, the common situation. So once they can do it, that's not inventive anymore. So the question is, what is different, whether it's inside or outside, if it's identical or not?